First of all, I want to thank the organizers to invite me. It is my second time in Korea. The last time it was in Kiev, and it was 6 years ago when I freshly graduated from Bayreuth. And we had a lot of fun in trying to learn skiing. Yeah. Today I want to talk about surface of general type with Q equal to 2. And I want to add one more question of Professor Galanis, although he has already posed a lot in the last lecture.
Yeah. The question.
Ah, nice. Yeah. After the talk. Yeah. Okay.
You mean that integrally?
Integrally? What? No, no. It's your question, yes. First, I want to recall a theorem of Kuranish. And the setup is quite general. So let X be a compact complex manifold. And M is the underlying differentiable manifold of dimension 2n if the complex dimension of X is n. And then we know that there's a famous theorem of Kuranishi saying that there is a semi-universal family called the Kuranishi family, X of X. So it's called Kuranishi family. But the theorem I want to recall is not this. It's a less known theorem of Kuranish. I found it in Fabrizio's survey paper, and I memorized it. Theorem of Kuranish. It's has a more topological flavor. So assume in this Kuranish family, if the dimension of each fiber, the cotangent bundle of each fiber, is a constant, function of t, then there exists a neighborhood U of the identity map in the group of diffeomorphism of the underlying differentiable manifold M, and with certain norm, with certain topology on this, but this is somehow the if M is compact, so it's there's no ambiguity. There's some topology on this big group, and a neighborhood of V of this this point B in B such that for any two points in U, so U is the neighborhood in the diffeomorphism group, and for any F from no, this is V. Sorry. F is not a holomorphic map from the complex manifold XT, the fiber over the point T, and to the XT prime, and this is the theorem. So maybe it's confusing at first sight. What does this mean? Diffeomorphism is not a holomorphic map. Let me explain a little bit. So differentiably, this family X there is isomorphic, is diffeomorphic, see infinitely this to a broader family, right? And this is a projection to the second factor. And so every fiber over point of B, we have a diffeomorphism. So M is equal, isomorphic, equal, identified as a fiber over point T. And also, the fiber over the point T prime is identified with M. Now I have a diffeomorphism F here, F from the yes. And of course, this is a map from this this manifold to this manifold. And this is, we have identified as a complex manifold with complex structure FC prime. So it's a map from a complex manifold to another complex manifold. And we can ask if it is holomorphic. A priori, it's a diffeomorphism, right? And this theorem says that in a small neighborhood, so this is diffeomorphism group of M. And this is identity component containing the identity map here. And I have a neighborhood U. And for any F, and of course there are other components of this whole full diffeomorphism group, but we do not care. We are concerning this. We're interested in this connect component of the identity. And on B is a Kuranish base from the Kuranish family. Kuranish base. And here's a point zero, and I have a V and T prime. And the theorem has something to say about this situation. And we want to, this is a local, has a completely local. There's a neighborhood in this group and in this base. If we want to make this statement global, then we encounter such the following question. So I consider, so is this theorem valid somehow globally? So we consider this the space of complex structures on M.
The central fiber has a finite automorphism group.
Yeah.
Right? It's non-trivial. So then you would expect that in any neighborhood, you take any T, there is a fiber which is T prime, which is isomorphic to it, right? You would expect that.
No. You mean isomorphic to the central fiber?
Not to the central, but the.
This is expected.
But
yeah.
As you will
explain,
they are non-trivial if they are, for instance, non-trivial on cohomology, then they are not in the neighborhood of the identity.
So it's different from this.
These are isotopic to the identity. They act trivially on all homotopy.
Yeah, what Fabrizio explained is that this the neighboring fiber might be isomorphic as complex manifold, but the diffeomorphism inducing it have come from here. So a component, not the identity component. Yes. So let me write C of X to be the connect component of this very big, infinite many dimensional, I would say. This is a containing the complex structure of X. It's easy to understand. So I have a big space and I have a component containing the and now
a complex structure is just an integral tensor.
Integrable, almost complex structure.
Right.
Yes.
So it's a tensor on M.
It's a tensor on M. Yeah, yes, I think so. Yeah. So the question now for a diffeomorphism. Is said to be isotopic to the identity map if it lies in the connect component. So this means I have a path of a diffeomorphism from this, for example, another diffeomorphism connecting this to the identity. So the question now is is there a holomorphic automorphism of XT? I would bracket here. Because by automorphism, I always mean it's a holomorphic automorphism for some T in. That is isotopic to the identity. This is a non-trivial part. Isotopic to identity. To ease the discussion, I will introduce some notions, definition, also by. So a complex manifold X is said to be rigidified if the automorphism group, holomorphic automorphism group, intersecting the identity component of diffeomorphism is only the identity map. This means there's the answer to this question is negative. So there's no I want to recall that this is a global version. If this has a negative answer, then we have a global version of the theorem of Kuranishi. Yeah. And cohomologically rigidified if this automorphism group X injects into the automorphism group of the core homology with integral coefficients and rationally cohomologically rigidified if I change the coefficients here that to be the rational coefficients. here is this, is injective. So obviously we have some implications. For example, so rationally cohomological rigidify is the strongest property. This implies this, right? And because this invariant is the most weak, and if this is already injective, then we have injection on for the integral cohomology. And this is the strong, weakest condition rigidified. But the weakest condition has a hope to be satisfied for all manifolds. And these are not satisfied for some manifolds, as I will show you by some example. So let me give yet more notions. So the kernel in this map I will call the numerically trivial automorphism. So this is automorphic numerical kernel. This is cohomologically trivial automorphisms. I've seen this, I think it's a natural question. And the kernel of this map is called the rational, it's a numerically trivial cohomology. This is trivial. A remark is that so this invariant is more tractable. So automorphism group of the cohomology with the Q coefficient is more tractable than the identical component of the diffeomorphism group, which is infinite dimensional, because we have its Lie algebra as a C infinity vector fields on M as Lie algebra. So up to now, we attack this problem by studying this. So if we have a proof that a manifold is rationally cohomology rigidified, then we can infer that it's they are rigidified. We cannot prove things directly by treating this big diffeomorphism group. Yeah, the easy going approach. And after introducing these several notions, let me give some examples. And to get a feeling of what is going on here. So some trivial conclusion from the definition. For example, if automorphism group is positive dimensional, then X is not rigidified. For example, this includes curves of genus less than or equal to 1, right? They have positive dimensional automorphisms. And also minimal rational surface. They have a positive global vector fields and and also bi-elliptic surfaces. And abelian surfaces. And first non-trivial example is this smooth curve. In some sense, C is rigidified if the genus of C is greater than or equal to 2. And also, we know that this condition is the same thing as saying that C is of general type. So the reason is quite, actually, the reason is not hard. There are several ways of proving this, but we want to generalize the proof to other situations. Then we have to take one of the proof. For example, I want to say this is, when we look at the Albanese map or the Jacobian, so we take the Albanese of C, and for any sigma, so in this group, so this group I define this to be the automorphisms tau x trivially on the cohomology C. So I can show this by showing that the C is a rational cohomology rigidified. And sigma, then this is identity map because it induces trivial action on the cohomology. So this is identity map. And we have two embeddings. If the ambient is already identity on the ambient space, then of course it induces the trivial action on C, right? Yeah.
There is this problem of the fixed point.
I have to kind of sloppy here. Yes. You have to show that as a starting point has fixed point. So fixed is not empty. Yeah. Otherwise, sigma can be a translation of a abelian variety, and it induces trivial action on the cohomology. But we can show that fixed point there's some fixed points of sigma, and then we have identity. Yeah. And K3 surfaces. Everyone, most of you know these are rationally cohomologically rigidified. I take shorthand for this notion, rationally cohomology. But it's a part of Torrey theorem. You can view this as part of Torrey theorem as a rigidified. Unring surfaces. So I have do some literature research. You will see that unring surface, general unring surface, have infinitely many automorphisms. So, and then there's some work by Wino and some mistakes, and there's a long history. And up to recently, Mukha has published a paper, I think in 2010, correcting some minor error in his former paper. And so the conclusion is that so if S is a Ulrich surface, which is not rationally cohomology rigidified, then the kernel of this action has a order less than or equal to 4. And similarly, for the stronger condition, cohomologically rigidified, this is a less than or equal to 2. And they are classified. This extremal case, equality case, are classified in by showing these are all in some example, in some example constructed before, so are classified. And this as a consequence of a work of Mukai, Namikawa, 84, and Mukai, a new paper in 2010. And also, before that, there's a paper by Peters and his co-author. So they have constructed some examples of such Ulrich surface, and Mukai classified them. So by he said somehow this the surfaces which are not rationally cohomology redefined, then they must be Peters' example, and he and Lieberman. I'm not here. It's the list of authors is not so complete here.
Example where this kernel is not finite.
Yeah, yeah. There are examples. Ulrich surface has finite automorphism, but the generic Ulrich surface has infinite automorphism. This is a result.
But he's asking whether the kernel.
The kernel, not zero.
Yeah, kernel always finite.
It will be always finite.
It's
yes.
Written there.
Yeah, in this case, but in general, I mean. Except other varieties in which this is not finite.
Rational surface can
and
P1. Positive dimensional phenomenon.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, in which the group is not in the non-trivial case in which the group is not continuous. Some Z, for instance,
if
possible to have Z as a kernel.
Hmm. Yeah, I think that there should be some example with infinite kernel. Yes. Yeah, I think for surfaces, the known examples are all has finite kernel.
Yeah.
Yeah. Including non-minimal rational surfaces. Yeah. It could have infinite kernel, but if it has infinite kernel, then it's come from the some holomorphic automorphism component of identity. Yeah. Okay, before we finally arrive at surface of a general type, let me also state an example of a minimal properly elliptic surfaces. These are also constructed by Peters. So these are the, in the same paper, published in the preceding of a conference. So the example looks like this. So S is E times D modulo some involution. You know, this E is a elliptic curve. And the genus of the second factor, GD, is greater than or equal to 2. And tau is the involution. Involution acting freely on sigma, yes, thanks. On D. So minus 1, of course, is the group automorphism of E. Of order 2, and so this is a free action, actually. So it has a quadratic dimension 1. And now we consider another, so this automorphism tau to be an automorphism on the covering E times D. So E for any point from on this surface, I transform it to be this point. And the point here is that this is also involution. Involution is commutative with this automorphism on this automorphism. So it descends to the quotient to give a involution of S. And it can be easily shown that this tau descends to an involution on S, which acts trivially on cohomology. Yes, to be more precise. Yeah, because this involution on the product does not, it's trivial on the whole cohomology of the product. If it descends, this cohomology of S is this invariant part of this automorphism. So the descent of tau tilde is X also trivial on cohomology. Yeah, the virtue of such a construction is that the cohomology of the surface is completely clear. So you can compute the whole cohomology group and to see if the automorphism acts trivially. And this is... it turns out that this kind of construction generalized to surface of a general type. And let me read this. So a theorem proved by me and my co-authors concerned on the surface of a general type case. So of course, surface of general type always have a finite automorphism group. So there's no issue of a positive dimensional component of the automorphism group. It's because it's trivial. And what we prove is surface of general type with irregularity Q greater than or equal to 3 are rationally cohomology redefined. So as a consequence, they are rigidified. And if we decrease the irregularity, we also have some results. So this is theorem one proved by and theorem two is about a surface of general type with irregularity two. Surface of general type with Q equals to 2. Then we cannot prove this. The rational cohomology redefined because we can find examples. What we can achieve is a bound on the kernel of the so it's two. The second part of the theorem is that there are unbounded series. Unbounded means that the invariants can go to infinity of general type. With irregularity 2 and this kernel to be the order 2. And these are constructed in this way. The difference is that we take two curves of genus greater than or equal to 2. And then take some automorphism group of the product acting freely on. So these are surface isogenate product. So let me make a comment about the proofs of theorem 1 and theorem 2. So idea of proof of theorem 1. So the condition of non-trivial kernel of the action auto zero of S to be non-trivial imposes strong restriction on the geometry of the surface. In particular, we can show that S has a maximal Albanese dimension. And the so-called generic vanishing index is greater than zero. So as we arrive at these two conclusions, then we can use some general some theory of generic vanishing to conclude. Yeah, this is generic vanishing, GV, the shorthand for generic vanishing. This is a generic vanishing index. Let me define it. So V1, I define this set as of the V1 of omega S is the canonical sheaf of S to be those line bundles, topologically trivial line bundles, such that the first cohomology of omega s tensored with alpha is non-trivial. This is a set. And then the generic vanishing of the first generic vanishing index is this codimension of this set in the whole Picard group of S minus 1. So if it is positive, this means the codimension is at least 2. Codimension of this set in this Picard 0 of S is at least 2. And this is a strong condition. And then the some black box, for me, general vanishing theory applies to give that if I have this such a diagram of and to the Abernethy map of S, of course, if the action, this action is topologically trivial, so, cohomology trivial, so the Abernethy of the quotient and Abernethy of S is the same. So, I denote by A. Then I have, I can compute that degree of this quotient map is 1. This means this automorphism group is trivial. Yeah. Very rough idea of the proof. Well, there are many details, of course.
When you write codimension, does that assume that V1 is not empty? The codimensional one is 2.
Ah.
It's 4.
Okay.
At least 4.
Yeah, because Picard zero is this dimension is greater than 3, right? Yeah, I haven't defined it, but it's greater than or equal to 3. Yeah, let's make this convention. Yeah, the important thing is that it's positive. The number here, in our case, does not matter much.
You did have two circuits same in the component of moduli, but this automorphism zero S can be different.
Yeah, of course. I expect this. Yeah.
Same component is different.
The same
model, no. So what does it mean that this unbounded series means?
No, this is, you know, if you take the moduli space with automorphism.
So let me go to theorem 2. Maybe we discuss later about this. So construction, I've said that some unbounded series of surface of general type with Q equal to 2 in theorem 2. There are two parts. One is about the construction. The other part is about the bound, right? Let me do it. Yeah, let's start. I take a product curve, as we have seen in the example of Peters. So it's, now we necessarily have the genus of the curves to be greater than or equal to 2. And now the cohomology is somehow clear for this product, you know, by Quinet formula. This is C D, right? I want to show this for this product X faithfully, the automorphism group of this X faithfully. So the kernel is non is trivial faithfully on the cohomology of S tilde. Because by Quinet formula I have some subset For example, H2C right, a component like this, and another component like this, or you can take any, for example, H0 is also okay. And then for any automorphism, and let me just show by an example. The automorphism S tilde might be a Z2 extension of this group, but let's take an automorphism from here. Then this sigma acts faithfully on this, right? For curve, we have shown that it acts faithfully. So this map, because tau always acts trivially on this, because this is a one-dimensional space, it's a volume spanned by the volume, right? So if sigma is non-trivial, then it acts faithfully on this component. If tau is non-trivial, then this automorphism acts trivially on the first component. So in any case, cannot act trivially on the cohomology, because we have the simple, right? Yeah. The point to construct examples which have a non-trivial kernel is to cut down the cohomology to a single piece. So S, if we take quotient, so let some GX on C and D, and we construct such that it acts freely on the product as a diagonal action. Then the let S be the quotient of this. Then the cohomology of S is the G invariant part of the cohomology of S tilde. I call it delta, the diagonal of G in the product of two copies of G. So and this is, I can decompose it into the characters, into different eigenspaces with respect to the action of a G. So C chi times chi. Yes. So choose carefully C, the pair C with a group action G, D with the action of G carefully. Yeah. Then we can have exactly one character irreducible character of this finite group G, such that the cohomology of the second cohomology of S is this H2CC. This component always persists in the decomposition, because any automorphism acts trivially on this, and another component, right? And yet, the third component is this. So H1C, C chi 0 times H1D chi 0 conjugate. Then if we have find such pairs and such decomposition, then we have a non-trivial kernel. Then kernel of chi 0 is contained in the automorphism, the kernel of the rationally cohomological action of the automorphism group. So this kernel, of course, if chi zero is non-trivial, then this is non-trivial. And because initially we have different characters, and we choose this carefully to make this all other character eigenspace vanish, and only one piece remains, and then the cohomology is particularly very simple, and we can have this kernel. So we construct an unbounded series of surfaces with a non-trivial kernel of the cohomological action. time is running, so. Classification of the surfaces in theorem 2. So we have found an unbounded series of surfaces, and there are then I've proved that all minimal surfaces of general type with Q equal to 2 and non-trivial kernel of the cohomological action, which is necessary of order 2. These surfaces are all isogenous to a product. I will just say this is a theorem proved last year, right, 15. So I proved that if I have this condition, then the surfaces are exactly as constructed just now. So, yeah. And the proof is, I use a newly established theorem about surfaces satisfying the Savary equality. This time is up, so I will not talk more about this. Q equal to 2, yes, we have examples which X not trivially. maybe I just write a few key steps to establish this. First, we prove the numerical equation about such surfaces. And then we know that the fixed locus of the non-trivial, the generator of the kernel consists of exactly 4 chi points. And S has maximal Albanese dimension. And you know, now if we look at the quotient of S by this sigma, then this satisfies this. This is a 4 chi OS, and this is a 4 chi of OS of the quotient. This is exactly the Savary equality. Then apply theorem of, so we have a Albanese of S quotient. And this satisfies Savary equality. And by a recent theorem of Lu and maybe it first published by Baha, Stoppino, Stoppino. And Li and Zhuo, also 2015. And then theorem says that the branch locus of this Albanese map of the quotient has only simple singularities. And we use these to recover the surface from this condition and to finally to prove this theorem. Okay. Yeah, I have to prove it. They are registered. Maybe 2 or 3 minutes. Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yep. So there's a proposition. Finally, because I want to show the theorem, so proposition. This is also in our joint paper, in 2013. So, let S be a smooth projective surface. Assume the universal cover of S is a bounded domain in C2. Then S is rigidified. So as a corollary of this proposition, I can say that I should not erase it. As a corollary, no, just bounded domain. So surface isogenous product. So the ones I constructed in theorem 2 for product are rigidified, and as a byproduct, I won't say that. So the surface on the Bogomolov Miyoka-Yau line are also rigidified, including in particular the fake projective planes. Right, they are rigidified. So I've shown that I classify the surface with irregularity 2 and the non-trivial kernel, and then by this proposition, I can say the surface of general type with irregularity 2 are rigidified by combining this and my theorem, my classification, and this is just a remark. So okay, I stop here. I'm just already over time. Sorry.